When the order came to start measuring the C-130 Hercules in preparation for an aircraft carrier landing and launch test, engineers at the Naval Air Test Center thought someone must be joking. With a wingspan of 132 feet, few could imagine that the C-130 would be able to operate off of a flight deck only 1,017 feet long and approximately 250 feet wide. But the Department of the United States Navy needed to find out the feasibility of landing large planes on carriers for resource transportation. As U.S. carrier fleets were being deployed around the world to increasingly more remote locations, the existing supply logistics relying on the Grumman C-1 Trader were proving insufficient. Configured for carrier operations, the small twin-engine C-1 had comparatively limited range and payload capacity. To solve the problem, the Navy assembled a team of shocked pilots and engineers to figure out how to land a colossal C-130 on the supercarrier USS Forrestal. Given the considerable uncertainty around the experiment, plans were made to toss the aircraft overboard with a crane should it prove unable to take off again. Hercules. The massive C-130 Hercules was first used by the Navy in 1960, when four of these aircraft were on Antarctic missions. Those models featured skis, but soon after, the Marine Corps procured 46 more Hercules planes for transport and to use as aerial tankers that could refuel fighter jets and attack planes. The aircraft was created after the United States Air Force Tactical Air Command sent in requirements for Lockheed to generate a combat transport with turboprop engines. It first flew in August of 1954 for the Air Force, and in January of 1960 for the Navy. As a tanker, the Hercules could refuel to other planes at the same time and could carry 3,600 gallons of fuel. Refueling happened through two detachable pylon pods located under the outer wing. The Lockheed KC-130F version of the Hercules entered service for the Navy in the Pacific on February 1, 1962. The plane was particularly useful for its ability to refuel aircraft, and several of the airframes were placed in the newly designated Marine Aerial Refueler Transport Squadron 152 under the Marine Corps. About a year after the Marines received these Hercules planes, the squadron was sent along with the expeditionary forces to assist F-4 and A-4 fighters in Vietnam. Still, the United States Armed Forces wondered whether the Hercules could be deployed from water rather than land to facilitate long-range cross-continental missions. The USS Forrestal. The USS Forrestal was a supercarrier commissioned in 1955 and named after the first Secretary of Defense, James Forrestal. The vessel was the United States' first of its class and the United States' first supercarrier. Unlike the subsequent nuclear carriers, the USS Forrestal harnessed conventional power. During its construction at Newport News Shipbuilding, the ship saw several design adjustments, including the replacement of a planned telescoping bridge for a traditional island structure. An angled landing deck and steam catapults were added to the flight deck, incorporating British design ideas. USS Forrestal was first launched on December 11, 1954. It entered service on October 1st of the following year. Sailors and officers affectionately referred to the vessel as the FID, short for First in Defense, and also a reference to James Forrestal. This nickname was integrated as a slogan on the vessel's insignia and patch. After some notable fires aboard the ship, the USS Forrestal also gained the monikers Forest Fire, Firestall, and USS Zippo. The worst of these fires took place in 1967. The supercarrier served in the Atlantic Ocean, the Mediterranean Sea, and the Pacific Ocean for almost four decades. In the end, it was decommissioned and turned into a museum. After several attempts to save the ship were unsuccessful, it was ultimately towed to Brownsville, Texas for scrap in February of 2014. By December of the following year, the ship had been entirely scrapped. The plan. The C-2 Greyhound is presently still one of the largest transport aircraft designed for carrier operations. Before the plane entered its service, however, the military was curious to see whether the C-130 Hercules could be used for logistics support by taking off and landing on a carrier. Tests using the Hercules and supercarrier USS Forrestal were scheduled for October of 1963. The theory behind the novel test was named Carrier Onboard Delivery, or COD, sometimes Supercarrier Onboard Delivery. The concept was created following the realization that aircraft carriers should be resupplied with urgently needed fuel and tools without having to return to port. Commencing in the early 1960s, the Grumman C-1 Trader was actually in charge of resupplying the carriers. However, the twin piston engine had two flaws that limited the operations: the 300-mile range and the 8,500-pound or 3,856-kilogram payload capacity. The Chief of Naval Operations, the most senior naval officer in the Department of the Navy, wanted a bigger transport plane to land on the USS Forrestal. He ordered the feasibility study to determine whether the C-130 Hercules could be used as a carrier onboard delivery aircraft. Aside from both greater range and payload capacity, the Hercules was a more stable and reliable aircraft. If it could replenish carriers in the middle of the ocean, it would resolve multiple concerns. The crew. The Navy-assembled crew to carry out the supercarrier onboard delivery was formed by Lieutenant James H. Flatley III, Pilot Lieutenant Commander W.W. Stovall, his co-pilot and flight engineer E.F. Brennan, and Lockheed's test pilot, Ted H. Limmer, Jr. Lieutenant James H. Flatley III would later recall in Commander Robert R. Powell's book Wave Off, A History of LSOs and Shipboard Landings, that, quote, "They could not find a C-130 crew interested in going to the boat. So the Naval Air Test Center fingered two fighter pilots who couldn't even spell propeller. They gave us the keys to a Marine KC-130. Reports say that when the assignment reached Lieutenant James H. Flatley III, he was surprised and thought that higher command was playing a prank on him. According to writer and Lockheed chief engineer at the time, Joseph Earl Dabney, Flatley asked, quote, "Operate a C-130 off an aircraft carrier? Somebody's got to be kidding." But of course, the unheard-of test was not a joke. It was a genuine curiosity that the United States Department of the Navy needed to resolve. Once the team was assembled, training commenced for the record-breaking tests. In Powell's book, Flatley stated that their preparation for the historical moment was rather brief, quote, "We had 1 4-hour familiarization flight with Lockheed's chief test pilot before making exactly 100 test landings on the runway at Patuxent River." The tests. Despite the quick preparation and experimental nature of the projects, Lieutenant Flatley made history by landing the Hercules transport plane on the deck of the USS Forrestal in 1963. The test broke the record by using Hercules as the largest onboard aircraft to successfully land and take off from an aircraft carrier. The only modifications Lockheed made to the original C-130 was giving it a smaller nose landing gear hole and an upgraded anti-skid braking system. They also removed the underwing refueling pods. They carried out these changes at the Lockheed plant in Marietta soon before conducting the tests. Flatley expressed afterward, quote, "The big worry was whether we could meet the maximum sink rate of 9 feet per second. They not only accomplished this goal, but got even better numbers." In total, the team made 21 full-stop landings and 29 touch-and-go landings during 4 distinct trips. The Hercules used was an in-service Marine Corps KC-130F tanker. For the first test, they traveled off the coast of Jacksonville, Florida, and conducted it on October 30th. The USS Forrestal's flight deck was cleared, and the arresting wires were removed because the Hercules lacked a tail hook. The weather complicated the mission since the crew had to deal with 40-knot winds and gusts of up to 60 knots. Despite these difficulties, they were resolute in their purpose. The Hercules had to approach the USS Forrestal a total of 42 times that day to conduct 19 touch-and-go landings. Lockheed's chief engineer would later recall that Art E. Flock, who was on the supercarrier to witness the tests, had stated, quote, "The sea was pretty big that day. I was up on the captain's bridge. I watched a man in the ship's bow as that bow must have gone up and down 30 feet. The ship was sped up to 10 knots to fight the wind direction and to reduce yaw motion. When the plane landed, it had 40 to 50 knots hitting the nose." Art E. Flock also recalled, quote, "That airplane stopped right opposite the captain's bridge. It was cheering and laughing. There on the side of the fuselage, a big sign had been painted that said, 'Look, Ma, no hook.'" The rest of the tests were conducted in moderately rough seas about 500 nautical miles or 930 kilometers off the coast of Boston and the North Atlantic Ocean. These November 8th tests broke the record for the largest and heaviest plane to ever land on an aircraft carrier, a record that still stands. To carry out the landing, Flatley put the propellers in reverse pitch while he was still 10 or 15 feet in the air to land. At the moment of touchdown, the Hercules was placed in full reverse and brought to a stop in 270 feet. For that first landing, the Hercules weighed 85,000 pounds, but the ambitious testing required increasing the weight up to 121,000 pounds. For the maximum weight tests, the crew used 745 feet to take off and 460 feet to land. By the end of the tests, the aircraft was able to even take off from the spot on the deck where it had landed last. At that point, the Hercules' wingtip was only 15 feet away from the ship's control island, leaving no margin for any mistakes. No room for error. After the record for the biggest aircraft to land on a carrier was broken, the Navy realized that while it was indeed possible to land a Hercules on a supercarrier, doing so would be impractical and unfeasible for regular operations. The room for error was simply too narrow. Furthermore, the Hercules was too big to fit on the elevators or to stay in the hangars, which meant traveling by sea with it would require significant modifications, if it could even be done. By 1966, the C-2 Greyhound program was operational, addressing most of the concerns that these tests were seeking to zone into. For his record-breaking actions, Lieutenant James H. Flatley III was given the Distinguished Flying Cross. The Hercules plane they used was deployed to Vietnam and later on to the Middle East for Operation Desert Storm and Iraqi Freedom. It was finally retired in 2003 to the National Naval Aviation Museum in Pensacola, Florida.